Okay, it is time for us to check sports here at Robin Hood Radio. And we're going to start this off with a tribute to the New York Yankees, team that has won 100 games 3 years in a row. Showed signs last year of not doing anything great. And this year, they've completely fallen apart. If you're a Yankee fan, give up on them this year, and we'll see what happens next year. Let's bring in Mike Kosy. Good morning, Mike.
That's really pretty good.
No, really, it's that there's the players are not consistent. The coaching is not consistent. And I'm not saying that they're a World Series club, but they're not also the type of club that they're playing like. It's just total disorganization. And
makes you think it's going to change next year?
Well, you don't know. But all I'm saying is if you're a Yankee fan this year, don't frustrate yourself. It's not the year. It's not the year. They won't probably even make a play-in game.
You want to know something?
What?
One out of the last 22 years haven't been the year.
I'm just talking about if you want to see winning baseball, not championship baseball. Most people, except a few nutheads, will at least accept winning season, a competitive season, a competitive club. What I won't accept from the Yankees is a club that is just not performing on any level, coaching, playing, you name it.
They haven't for a long time. It's nothing that's new.
I don't know. 3 100-win seasons in a row is not.
Yeah, but even when they had those 100-win seasons, I've been telling you that they lack these things.
Yeah. Well,
the only reason why they had 100-win seasons is because the rest of the league was so inept.
Well, you know, but you still, it's just different. So I'm done. I'm all set to move on. Now I need to
know. What are you going to move on to, the Giants?
No, I'm going to move on to watching more movies. And then I'll move on to the Giants, and at least I only have to worry about the Giants once a week, okay? And I even get an off week during that. But anyway, so your winning streak is over.
Yeah, we ran second and third to the favorite.
Yeah. Hey, what a season you had. Two winners in the Triple Crown and then a second place? Hey, come on, that's not too bad.
Not just the winners, the exactors in the triple, too. I mean, you cashed every ticket you wanted to.
Yeah,
but I tell you what, it was beautiful at Belmont Saturday. 11,000 people were all they let in that big cavernous tomb. 11,000 people. It was like nobody was there. It was so comfortable. It was unbelievable how nice it was.
And you had a good day?
Oh, yeah, well, my best bet of the day was the race after the Belmont. I told all my buddies that, and it saved the day for everybody. My one friend, he cashed out for $5,800.
Wow.
And he said he got himself even.
Oh, God.
Yep, so, it was really, really good. And, you know, when you think about it, they didn't destroy you with prices. They were only selling one type of beer. It was I don't mean a type, but size. It was 24 ounces, and the can. It was $13. So it breaks down to $6.50 for a can. That's not bad at something like the Belmont. So it wasn't bad. It was really, like I said, really comfortable. You moved around. A lot of kids, young kids, got drunk as usual. One kid was hanging over. I don't know. You haven't been to Belmont, but around the paddock, it's like tiered with rails. And, like, you can lean on the rails with your elbow, with your form and whatnot. Well, this kid was leaning on the rail with his chest yakking. So, you never know. You never know what you're going to run into in New York. But it was a good job by Belmont. Thank you, Governor Cuomo, for only letting 11,000 people in. I'm sure there was a lot of disgruntled people, but I wasn't one of them.
I went to Belmont once.
Yeah, but I didn't know that. I mean, the paddock area, yeah. it's a nice paddock. It's tiered. It's kind of like the old Senate in Rome, where you're above the horses. It was good, but this one kid used it as a puking post.
No, it was one of those crazy Joe experiences where we went to Belmont. But anyways, we'll move on. How about DeGrom? You know what his ERA is now?
Mm-mm.
0.62.
What's his win-loss record?
Yeah, I know. It's crazy. But he is so good. He's 5-2 actually. He should be 7.
He's good. You know, I had this argument with my nephew last night. He's not Bob Gibson.
No, he's not Bob Gibson.
Good by today's standards. Yes. He's the best pitcher in baseball. But these kids today think that these other guys were, like, I don't know, coming out of wheelchairs and pitching or whatever. You know, you can't argue the point that baseball was better back then than it is now, and these people argue the other way. Strikeouts are up. Pitchers don't go the distance. Batting averages are bad. Fundamentals are gone. How can you say today's game is better? I don't understand. But in today's game, DeGrom's the best pitcher there is.
Well, the talent pool's too big. You know, back then, even in football and hockey and everything, you had a smaller talent pool, so you had better players that filled up more rosters, and it was a better product. I mean,
these people today are brainwashed because all they watch is that stupid flat screen TV, and they have nothing to base opinions on except what they're fed.
You know what I saw yesterday? Somebody posted he's got a vintage baseball photo site on the web. It has a picture of the St. Louis Cardinals and Bob Gibson's rookie year. And you know team pictures, all the players are together. Well, if the guy circled out the picture, Bob Uecker was the catcher for Bob Gibson that year.
Wow.
And they got a circle around the two of them. Everybody's sitting there with their hands folded in their laps. Gibson and Uecker are sitting there holding each other's hands. It was a classic picture. It was a great picture. You know, Gibson and I was joking around with Uecker. But yeah. No, people that didn't see Bob Gibson pitchers, or even I'll say Tom Seaver, you know, these were pitchers. I mean,
you watch these guys today, and all they do is you see them lift up that leg kick and come down. All they're trying to do is time the pitch. That's all they're trying to do with it. Well, if you lifted up that leg and put it down against Bob Gibson, you'd be falling backwards on yourself because not only did he throw 95, he had that big curveball and he changed speeds on it. He'd have you looking silly.
It's a great.
So like my nephew says, well, look at the swings these guys took. Yeah, look at the swings they took because you didn't know if you were going to get a 95-mile-an-hour fastball or 72-mile-an-hour curveball. You couldn't lock and load. That's the difference in the game. And today's people think, you know, it's all flash of how you look. It's not how you look. It's how you perform. And the players of the 80s, the 70s, and the 60s highly would outperform today's players. Are today's players in better condition? Probably. But they're not as good as the players of those days.
No, not at all.
Condition? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But in technique and capabilities, not even close. Can you imagine Tony Gwynn hitting against the shift? Because Tony Gwynn can pull the ball anytime he wants. So load up the right side against Tony Gwynn. He'll hit 550 for the season.
Funny story about Bob Gibson. In the last game he pitched, some guy hit a home run off him, okay? That was his last pitch in the major league, all right? Two or three years later in an old-timers game, the two of them came together and Gibson...
Gibson probably tried to strike him out.
No, he tried to hit him.
Try to hit him? Yeah, I mean, it's a different game today. It's not a better game by any means.
Well, anyways, I love listening to those stories from those days.
Well, coming home from the Belmont, we were all listening to the Islander game in the car, and the Islanders in a must-win situation against Boston pulled it and tied up the series at 2-2.
Yeah.
Tonight's game's at an odd time, starting time of 6:30 tonight.
Yeah, they beat the Bruins 4-1. Yeah, that was a very big game.
Well, it was a close game. I mean, they got two empty netters, but it was 2-1. They scored with 6 minutes left, and that 6 minutes was a long ride in the car waiting for that game to be over. And luckily, the Islanders got a couple of empty net goals to make the score look a lot different than it actually was. It was a real, real close game, as has been every game that they've played.
In basketball, the Nets down the Bucks 115-107 to take a one-game-to-none lead.
Back to hockey again, though. The Canadiens, who we spoke about last week, who were down 3-1 against Toronto and came back and beat Toronto in 7, well, now the Canadiens have a 3-to-none lead against Winnipeg. So they've won their last 6 games in the playoffs. That's a hell of a streak in
hockey. Yeah, when you get down to the final teams, absolutely. Absolutely, because it's the best against the best.
Yeah, I mean, being down 3-1 and winning 3, to take the series in seven, you would think that they'd have a little bit of a breakdown coming off of that. They won the next three against Winnipeg, so there actually might be a team in Canada in the finals in the Stanley Cup.
Can you imagine if
first time in about 100 years?
If Montreal, if the Canadiens won the Stanley Cup, can you imagine what would go on in Montreal?
Oh, the probably a place would burn down.
Yeah. Well, no, the Canadiens won't burn it down, but they'll go crazy.
My friends I was with Saturday, they're big hockey fans too, and we were trying to figure out when the Stanley Cup final is. We're thinking it's going to be around the 4th of July or maybe later.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing.
That's crazy.
It's
absolutely
nuts.
Crazy. But I think hockey, it gets back on track this year with the regular season starting in October. And, again, when we went to Belmont, the arena, the outside of the arena,
yeah,
dwarfs Belmont Park. And it's a gorgeous facility on the outside. So looking forward to seeing what that arena is going to look like for the Islanders, but it's a great, nice looking brick building.
All right. Well, with that being said, any other sports?
No, that's it.
All right. Well, unless something major happens, like the Yankees fire their manager, I'll speak to you on Friday.
Could happen.
It could. It very well could happen.
If they lose two games to the Orioles this week, it's going to happen.
Well, we'll see. But if it happens, I'll call you up and we'll do sports the next day.
Well, got it. No problem.
All right, Mike. Take care.
Have a great day.
Mike Causey with the Check on Sports this morning here on The Breakfast Club on Robinhood Radio.